James Lendemer, and I am an assistant curator at the New York Botanical Garden in the Institute of Systematic Botany, and I'm an assistant professor at the City University of New York Graduate Center. Lichens are fungi that have developed an unusual lifestyle that involves entering into partnerships with algae and other organisms like them for the purposes of obtaining nutrition, where these two things that look completely different, so an alga and a fungus, get together and they form a new thing that looks completely different from the two parts if they grew independently on their own. So lichens are found everywhere on land, and the only place they really aren't found is in the oceans. So in the southern Appalachians, we have a few species that actually grow directly submerged in streams. But by and large, they're on rocks, they're on trees, they're on soil, everywhere around you. Or at least they should be. Lichens come in three main growth forms. Are the crustose lichens, those are the most diverse and the least studied. They're the ones that look like just paint on a rock or a tree, so they're just firmly attached to their substrate. They have an upper surface, but they don't have a distinct lower surface, and that's because it's as though you just put your hand onto something, you can't remove it. They're just growing there. It looks like they were painted on. The second kind of lichens that are a little bit more complex than that are foliose lichens. So imagine if you took your crustose lichen off that thing that it was growing on, and it has its upper surface and lower surface, and it has little root-like things that aren't actually roots, so that's how it attaches to the things that it grows on. It's like a leaf, and just like a leaf, there's an upper surface and a lower surface. The upper surface is one color, the lower surface is another color. The third kind of lichen is a fruticose lichen. Fruticose lichens are bushy and shrub-like. They usually grow either up, erect from the substrates that they're on, or they grow down, dangling down from the substrates that they're on. But regardless, they're the same color all the way around on all of their surfaces, and they are not flat and leaf-like. Lichens are special because they are these really unique organisms. They're these really unique things where these two completely different types of life, right, fungi and algae, get together and they form something that's completely unlike the constituent parts, and they can't survive on their own, and we see them everywhere. How are they important? So if you think of a terrestrial ecosystem like the forests here in the southern Appalachians and the Great Smoky Mountains, they really fill in all sorts of important roles and functions in the ecosystems. So all sorts of animals eat them and use them for like nesting material. So hummingbirds and other birds use them to make their nests. Flying squirrels do the same. And then there's all sorts of little snails that use them by eating them and other invertebrates that eat them. There's seedlings that fall into them and then germinate. And so they actually need the lichens there to provide the right environmental conditions for the seedlings to germinate. They also are involved in regulating the temperature and the humidity of a forest. So if you don't have lichens in a forest, there's a potential for the forest to become too hot or too dry. And the reason for that is that lichens have this amazing capacity to dry out completely. And then as soon as any water comes by, maybe in, you know, a fog, cloud or as rain, they suck up multiple times their dry weight in with moisture, and then they release it slowly back into the environment. So they don't just have the water sort of pass right through them, but rather they act like a sponge. And then that on a really large scale with the number of lichens that normally grow in a healthy forest is one of the things that helps the forest stay sort of moist and in the right temperature range, so that little invertebrates, which are sort of the base of the food chain for so many things, can survive, right? It helps so many different things in the environment. They're also really important in nutrient cycling because lichens, so things like the nitrogen cycle and many other elements, are really important to ecosystem functions. And what lichens do is when they are attached to their tree or they're on their rock or something and then they die, the lichen starts to decompose. And so it inputs nitrogen into the forest that way. And you know, it might be hard to imagine one lichen contributing in a really meaningful way, but when you have thousands and thousands of lichens in even a small area of forest doing this, that actually contributes in a huge way. And so in the southern Appalachians and many other temperate forests lichens contribute substantially to nutrient cycling. That's actually the case in areas all over the world. So like in deserts, there are biological soil crusts that are formed of lichens and all sorts of other little plants and animal-like things. And basically, they're what holds the soil together. So if you lose those, all the soil blows away. That's essentially what happened during the Dust Bowl. Lichens get their food two main ways. First, they actually get most of the nutrients they need from the alga inside of them. So when we talk about lichens, we're talking about fungi that have this special lifestyle, and those fungi have captured these algae inside of them, and they're basically farming them. And so they get their nutrients from the algae inside of them. They get all of the other things that they need, other nutrients and minerals, from the environment, from rain, where the nutrients and minerals are sort of dissolved in the rain, when the water comes to them and they suck it in, and then they get their actual food from the algae inside of them. A huge, you know, range of things, from the smallest animals to the biggest animals. So everything from little lacewing larvae to snails and birds and flying squirrels, and then reindeer. So reindeer subsist on lichens for 80% of their diet in the winter. So there's a whole range of animals, both in our region and in many other regions, that rely entirely on them for some part of their lifestyle or their life cycle, including for food. For lichens, just like many other small and sort of underappreciated groups of organisms, things like insects, I would argue that the biggest thing that you can do is to recognize that these different life forms are really not currently protected by and large by existing conservation laws and conservation plans. And so the biggest thing we can do is recognize that what we need to do is incorporate things like lichens and fungi and insects into our strategies that we already have to protect plants and animals that already exist. So we already have the mechanisms in place to protect and conserve these things. It's just a matter of sort of actually incorporating them into those processes that are already there.